Okay, well, thank you all very much for coming on. We're going to, what will happen is that people kind of come in at certain points in the talk. We're going to keep it pretty relaxed, but hopefully content rich, definitely content rich. That's the way it's going to work. So, welcome everybody to Sluice. I want to say just a couple of things about Sluice before I introduce our speakers. So this is the third Sluice Art Fair that we've done in London, and we showcase artist-run activity and initiatives from all over the UK, in fact, all over the world. And we are always free. It's always free to get in. It's always free to take part in a workshop, like a fish printing workshop. That's what you can see around you. That was yesterday. Coming to a talk like this, watching a screening, etc., etc. So we ask, we beg, we ask that if you are willing or interested in supporting us, that you might buy a catalogue, which is only £5 downstairs, and every penny really does count. So thank you. And we have 5 floors and more talks happening for the rest of the day. So I just wanted to say that very briefly. This is one of our panel discussions. We had 2 days ago, we had a panel discussion about public art. One yesterday about contemporary art and old masters and historic collections, and today about copyright, copyleft. All of our talks are always filmed, this is being filmed, and it will be archived and put onto our website as all our other talks are. So if you like this talk, you may wish to see it again, or you may wish to look back at our archive and watch some of the ones we've done over the years. Lots of things to see. So that's all for me about Sluice, but I want to start really by introducing, get out of the bloody light. I'm gonna start introducing the speakers that we have here today for this talk, which I think will be really, I'm really looking forward to it. It's gonna be very, very interesting, and I want to introduce all of them now on my phone. So I'll start with Masha on the far right. Masha McConaghy is a curator and researcher with a PhD in arts from Paris University, Panthéon Sorbonne, and museology degree from Louvre School, Paris, France. Extensive experience in exhibition organisation as an independent curator and as an assistant to curators of the renowned museums in Paris. Co-founder of Ascribe, who we're working with on this talk, a Berlin-based startup that empowers artists to unlock value from their digital creations through secure registration of authorship, easy transfer, and analytics. Excellent. So we've got Keh as well. Keh Ng, do I think?
Ng.
Sorry. Every time. I try to prepare it. I'm sorry. Studied his Masters of Fine Arts at Central Saint Martins in 2009 and has exhibited internationally in Sydney, Beijing, Rio de Janeiro, Chongqing, Chiang Mai, Amsterdam, Berlin, New York, Bristol, Manchester, and London. Keh is also one half of the Modern Language Experiment, which is an artist-led project that he runs with Matthew Stock. The project has led to collaborations that have been shown at the Tate Modern Bookshop, the MoMA PS1 Book Fair, and as part of a film marmalade screening at the Arnolfini. He is currently collaborating on the Art and Labour Show, which will culminate in a live game show upstairs at 3 p.m. today.
3:30, actually.
Sorry, 3:30. And you can see their work upstairs in the top floor of this building. And finally, Laura Davidson. Laura Davidson is a London-based writer covering emergent themes within digital culture and artistic practices. This year, she's been a regular contributor to Saturation Point, producing 2 catalogue essays for the exhibitions from Centre, co-curated with Slate Projects, and Generator. Her writing has appeared on This Is Tomorrow, Empirica, and Rhizome. So we've got an excellent panel of people working critically within the realm of digital art practice. So I think that our talk will be really fascinating. It's really fascinating for me because it's a kind of new area for me. But what I'll do is I'll give you, before I hand over, first of all to Laura, I'll give you a description of the talk from the way that we've described it in our lineup so that you know, you have a sense of where we're going to be going with this. Hold on a second. How is the virality of digitized art affecting the perception of creative production? What light can be thrown on this post-internet battleground by contextualizing it within an art historical framework? So we have a big job ahead. So I'm gonna start by handing over to Laura. And
okay.
When you wanna move the slide on, just
okay, I will do, okay. Okay, so
I've written an essay for the Sleuths magazine, which focuses on part on the commercialisation of the internet and payment systems for artists working digitally. The commercialisation of the internet, which I mentioned in the essay, is introduced as an important cultural waypoint, as it turns the net from a utopian and idealised space separate from the market and towards one which is integrated within our consumer culture. I think one of the main reasons my essay focuses on payment systems is in part because the immateriality of net-based works imply that they are practices which are not financially sustainable for the artist or the gallery. The art market apparently needs objects to sell. Owning something which can be endlessly shared removes its marketability and perhaps indeed its ownership. Owning something which can, copyright and intellectual property are of course always linked to the accreditation and ownership of an idea or work to an individual or corporation and to the subsequent collection of money for the owner. Accreditation is important to workers who labour within what are described as the knowledge or immaterial economies, of which it could be said where both artists and writers reside and any other types of creative practitioners. Without a reputation, it is difficult to work. There is also suggestion in the final lines of my essay for the magazine that our current economic situation makes the production of any kind of artistic work within the confines of a city like London precarious. The precarity is a result of London's prominent position within the streams of endless capital and money, which has accumulated unchecked across international borders and has forced the city to become witness to both acute wealth and acute poverty this activity of wealth creation brings. You have no choice but to generate a significant amount of income to survive within London's cultural sector. So, you may be wondering, what has all this got to do with copyrights? There have been suggestions that the internet has caused the earnings of creative professionals to freefall, in part due to misappropriation of work, little compensation on digital platforms, and individuals sharing with wild abandon and piracy. The lack of earnings across creative sectors has therefore been attributed to the lack of regard for copyright. I mean, I think when Napster first came out, that was a massive big deal, which is a very long time ago, and not due to massive growing income disparities across all labour markets and professions in Western economies. Specifically defining copyright as an income stream, Lewis Hyde, who's the author of the book Common as Air, Revolution, Art and Ownership, suggests that copyright can be viewed as a gift from the state to creative professionals who navigate professions where it is difficult to make money or establish a regular income. Copyright ensures a way for artists to pay their own way and additionally allows them to establish a reputation to earn money in the future. I would argue that Hyde's argument is convincing in this respect, but sort of as an aside, I think on the whole he's more agnostic and critical about issues of ownership and copyright, and especially in the relationship to capitalism. Okay, so at the V&A last month, the symposium Friction and Fiction, IP, Copyright and Digital Futures, it was organised by Create and Goldsmiths. Martin Krepschner from the University of Glasgow presented data from an economic study of the earnings of creative professionals. So this isn't just linked to the art market. So some of the data is more general, but he was talking about cultural markets. So he presented data from an economic study of the earnings of creative professionals over periods of time. One study revealed that cultural markets in general, are winner take all labour markets, and this statistic is very specific. The top 10% of photographers and illustrators take 45% of the market share, according to his study. And this narrative of a top minority percentage taking majority earnings is kind of like the economic saga of this epoch, at least reported in the press. It's unclear how the correct implementation of copyright makes this top percentage high earners, or if the reason they are high earners within their sectors is linked to other economic indicators, such as their social class and educational backgrounds. Krepschner also cited another report conducted by the University of Bournemouth, which was conducted 2 years ago, which showed a third drop in the medium incomes of professional authors between 2005 and 2013. Again, is this to do with the proliferation of pirated material online, digital platforms, or is it more to do with the general trend of medium income drops post-2008 and the disappearance of an economic middle in general in Western workforces? Okay, so my thoughts are, as if Lewis Hyde suggests, copyright is an income protection mechanism for a creative workforce looking to earn money. Why is it failing, and what should we do about it? Is it really copyright that is failing to protect the creative workforce, or is it just a wider economic system failing to protect all workers? The symposium at the V&A certainly saw grey areas between sharing your work to establish a reputation, which may lead to financial benefit, and recognising that contributing to a cultural commons is important, but also that attribution and earning a wage is also important too. Okay, so another turn my essay takes is the idea that art itself can navigate solutions by critiquing issues of ownership, copyright and economics. And in particular, the immateriality of net-based art has proven a problem for the accumulation of money and capital, which is the opposite of object-based works, or at least the kind of object-based works that you see at Frieze at the moment. These practices do not suit the traditional commercial gallery object model and have often been in a position to critique economic systems. Uber Morgan's Google will eat itself buys Google shares with money generated from Google ads. Other artists have offered alternative payment models like Raphael Rosendahl's website sales contract and Bitcoin Cloud, which builds a direct relation between the attention it receives and its market value, which is similar to Petra Cartwright's formula of pricing YouTube videos in relation to view count. In relation specifically to piracy and the cultures around that, and publishing, directly confront our culture of ownership and seek to understand how cultural piracy builds a cultural commons. Here, piracy across the internet and networks is seen as a way to challenge a system where access to knowledge and artifacts is restricted by geography, social affiliations, or wealth. The main message that I take from Anne Publishing is that piracy fosters an environment of cultural production as opposed to cultural censorship by removing barriers to access. Do you have the slide of Richard Prince, the Instagram? Okay. So just loosely, I want to refer back again to this idea of an elite within the cultural labour market and what this might mean in relationship to copyright and ownership. At Frieze New York this year, Richard Prince had work for sale in excess of $100,000. Prince had taken the images displayed at Frieze with some alterations from Instagram. And this is, I think these are when the images were displayed at the Gagosium. He had taken the images from Instagram, but he had not generated the images. Yet I suppose his position within the art world elite allowed him the privilege to scrape these images from the internet and then resell them as his own. In a way, you could say that his practice makes a unique cultural statement about ownership within our current cultural climate. However, how his actions foster a positive environment of shared cultural production and appreciation in the same way that the AND Publishing Project seeks to do, I'm cynical about. In my opinion, his actions say more about his perceived cultural entitlement as an artist that's winning in a winner-takes-all market than it does about the nebulous cultural situation that we're going to be discussing today. So I'll leave you with one final thought. Our connections, relationships, interests, browser history, and ultimately keystrokes all carry a value. This is why Google shares have been valued so much on stock markets. The personal information we give away freely through search engines and social media channels and web-based email clients like Gmail is worthy of being mined by advertisers to market products back to us. Based on the algorithms corporations like Google create for this very purpose. Within the essay in the magazine, I refer back to the artist Erica Skurte, who deals with these issues within her practice. It's also worth stating that these incursions into private communications also have a political value. This particular type of intrusion features in the refrain of the track Home by Holly Harnden, which is, "I know that you know me better than I know me." Written in reaction to the Edward Snowden revelations, Home explores the personal unease felt by the enormity of government-sanctioned information gathering over the internet. Herndon's music currently explores the ambiguous space between corporate and governmental spying. In both systems, the consumer and citizen are not compensated or accredited for their input. So why are the agents of power allowed access to our personal information, yet somehow we aren't allowed to distribute our shared cultural history for free.
Excellent. So there's lots of really interesting ideas that have already come up. That's fantastic. I'm going to hand over to you now, Masha, to talk about what you do.
Okay.
It seems to me that it makes sense to hand over to you at this stage. So I'm going to go to your presentation. And again, just shout out when you want the slides to move on.
Okay. Are you sure you don't want me to?
No, I'll do it.
Cool. Okay, hi everyone. So we're talking here about digital art, and that's therefore there are so many questions. You can move the slide. You know, like in Belgium, when you order a beer, you just do it like this.
Do that. I'll also bring you a beer or something.
Yeah, by the end of the presentation, I'll talk. Okay. So, how do you own something when bits can be copied freely? How do you share your digital work without losing attribution and control? How do you track provenance of digital file when it is hard to prove digital ownership? It feels very weird. This is the problem that has been explored again and again in the art world. The elephant in the room, according to the organizers of the Padel Zone in 2013. How can artists make a living in this new world? How can collectors truly own the digital work they purchase? DRM, traditional digital rights management options like watermarking or encryption, do not solve the problem. It only makes a 15-year-old who can hack very happy. DRM is fighting the physics of bits. The physics of bits mean that copies can be made and shared freely. Can you reclaim it and collect its value? The answer is intellectual property. For the art world, the particular brand of intellectual property law that matters is copyright law. When you create a work, you get copyright for it. By using copyright law, it's possible to transfer ownership and usage rights. So why hasn't it been widely used? And the answer is, it's too hard to use. The law is very clear when it comes to physical objects, but when it comes to digital intellectual property, it is very ambiguous. We have 180 different copyright laws in 180 different countries. It is expensive. In short, messy, not easy for individual users to use. So, when the ownership transactions happen, where does it get recorded? You could have it in a database or an Excel spreadsheet of a gallery or a marketplace that keeps track of every sale provenance. But what happens if that database gets hacked, or the organization gets corrupt, or even goes broke? Imagine instead you had a spreadsheet in the sky with thousands of copies that no one owned. Anyone can add an entry to it, no one can delete from it. Then you don't have to worry about some centralized entity getting hacked or going broke. This is precisely what a scribe is doing. We are using a very special spreadsheet, a spreadsheet in the sky called the Bitcoin blockchain. No one owns it, and at the same time, everyone owns it. So your transactions are remembered, yet not locked down by your gallery or by a scribe. A scribe offers a technology-based solution that reconciles the physics of bits. It empowers digital creators through immutable attribution by registering your copyright on blockchain technology, clear licensing baked in contracts for easy transfer of rights, literally by email, and visibility, coming soon analytics, to track impact and usage of your creation, a digital proxy for value. In conclusion, there is a solution to own digital art. It draws on centuries-old legals and makes them easy to use. And it draws on very new spreadsheet technology, blockchain. It's built for you, the creators, the collectors, the connectors of the art world.
Fascinating, thank you. But it's really already, I think, just such a fascinating fault line, seems to me, between the tradition of appropriation in art, which is something that Laura's touched on, especially with this, with the Richard Prince piece, and then the demands of having to operate within a kind of marketplace, quote unquote. So it's a really fascinating thing. I mean, with it, I think we might perhaps return to this Richard Prince thing, although obviously we're talking about something that is kind of physicalized, as it were. But it's a fascinating thing. I think we'll move on to Keh now, is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
And move into to a practitioner.
Okay.
Practitioner in the room.
Great, thank you.
So here you go.
So I haven't prepared a presentation, everyone, but listening to both Laura and Masha, the things that come to mind as being the most pertinent points are the ideas of appropriation, copy, and ultimately value, I think is what's at stake here. And as an artist and as an organizer for, that's at SLUS for the third time, the type of project that we run, the values that we have are very, very far away from the commercial value of art. I think for us, we pretty much expect never to make money out of our art practices or SLUS. What's at stake for us are ideas, freedom, the freedom to make the works that we care about. And when you think about the ideas of appropriation and even theft, I mean, that could be considered issues that we should probably address. But to me, it's that language doesn't really resonate with me. I mean, one of the statements on SLUS's site, which is the idea of just being a battleground, I don't actually see it's a battleground. I see it's a playground. The idea of copyright or copyleft. These are things that we can play with, can use to manipulate for our own needs and desires. Because if what's at stake for us isn't money or isn't our reputation, and if we accept that, we're going to piss people off and people are going to piss us off, it's fine. Let's go ahead and make the most interesting works we can. I can't speak for all artists, however. I mean, I'm not Richard Prince. I mean, I think there are artists whose, the image or the reproduction of their images is very important to them. In my personal practice, it isn't. In my personal practice, actually, if someone were to appropriate, copy, or steal my work, it would be the best result ever. I'll explain in a minute. the picture we're looking at up here is one of the artists in our show upstairs. That's a piece of his. The artist is Warren Garland. And his work is involves ultimately stealing images from the internet, stealing images from other people's videos and making them into his own videos. Well, stealing's a strong word because actually by the time it enters his own work, it becomes something new. It's borrowed, it's reappropriated. And I guess that's one of the things about that's one of the things that's unique to the art world for me in terms of the other digital creative spheres. Art has a long history of appropriation, copying and stealing from other people. All the way back to the Renaissance, the masters and the apprentice. It is in our nature to learn from what's come before us, to take ideas of today and to play with them and try and make them our own and be free to think, okay, well, I'll put something out there and someone's going to knock it down 5 minutes later. That's okay, that's cool, because that's the discourse, that's what you've bought into as an artist. In this piece here, Warren's got, I think he's got Arnold Schwarzenegger, I think he's got a Teletubby, I believe that's an image from Hitchcock, and he uses repetition pattern to create a new story or a new narrative, which in his work very often related to the class system. It's often related to freedom, and you know these themes come out again and again with his work. So I think for him the idea of infringing copyright and is actually fine. And I remember once going to a lecture where someone was talking about copyright, not copyleft, but if as long as you can afford not to lose everything, by all means go ahead, steal, borrow, and destroy, because actually nobody's going to come after you unless actually you have something at stake of monetary value. If somebody comes after you at you for your ideas, great, that's interesting, that creates a conversation. So what's the next image we've got then? That's a bit hard to see. Well, the artist here is Tina Hage. So Tina borrows, appropriates, steals images from the internet, from media publications. She steals images, she borrows images which are iconic to the day. So this is the G20 protest. She's also done images of the Wall Street crash. She's also done images of the refugees leaving Syria. And she takes iconic images shot by probably Magnum award-winning photographers who have very strong copyright in their images. She takes these images and remakes them with herself as the model in every image. And one of the things that was interesting about this image was apparently when she was looking at her Google Analytics, this image is being looked at more, it's being looked at most often in Russia, which is weird. She's a German artist who's based in London. Her website is most frequently looked at by people in Russia, then in Brazil, then England, then Germany. And when we spoke to someone who was based in Russia, they were saying, oh yeah, your works are probably being put on t-shirts and being used, being borrowed and taken away. And at first she was upset. Then we had a chat about it. She said, actually, but I took this image myself from somebody else. And I guess it's, in relation to today's discussion, I guess that was a non-complicit version of copyleft, where actually, people, an image has been borrowed and borrowed again. And if that is the practice, I guess really what ends up happening is what's commonly known as public domain. She could go and chase somebody, and somebody could come and chase her, but really, to what end? This is, what's at stake for us as artists is our culture, it's our ideas. So for a photographer to chase her down and say, hey, you stole my G20 image, what's that really gain? And I guess that's the question for us. What's the next image we've got then? Right, so this is a piece I appropriated, actually. This is a piece, my work is interested in urban myths and urban stories. And so I live in Hackney, and one of the stories I found one day was about these boys who started telling a story of a headless bear in the marshes in Hackney. So I guess they've got the copyright of that story. But anyway, they started telling everybody the story of this headless bear that they saw in the marshes. And because they were kids, the police took it very, very seriously. And next thing you know, there were police sweeping the marshes hand in hand, going through the marshes looking for this headless bear. Of course, there was no headless bear, and someone ended up being arrested. So that was in the 80s. So I found a story and I thought, okay, what would be cool is if I got myself a bear suit, went down to the marshes. Got someone to take a photograph of me, I photoshopped my head off and sent it to the press. Then I hired an actress to talk to the press when they contacted me, and then we were talking to The Sun, the Hackney Gazette, the Daily Mail, and eventually the story hit the press, and we have here the a piece in the newspaper. What was interesting for me, though, wasn't just this bit, was what happened next. So all of a sudden, on the internet, this story sort of blew up. And people were going, oh, this guy's making this up, it's not real. And I don't know if you guys remember the band Cooler Shaker. You know, most of you are probably too young. But Cooler Shaker, the drummer of Cooler Shaker also lives in Hackney. And he started getting really upset. And he started saying, actually, that's my dog. It's not a bear. And so, yeah, if you look on the internet today, there's still lots of stories of this drummer from Cooler Shaker trying to take ownership of the story, which I thought was great, because my practice is about urban myths and the perpetuation of stories. I thought, great, you run with that. You can have that, actually. And that, to me, that was really cool. So I guess the final image we've got was a piece by Roisin Byrne. When I knew we were going to be talking about this topic today, I was sort of digging around, trying to think of stories of copyright theft, and actually I realised it was all around me, but a really good urban myth that came up was of a goldsmith student who was stealing other people's works at uni and then calling it her own. And she was causing friction and people hated her, and she was starting this little movement of goldsmiths. And actually when I picked it, I realised it was probably Roisin. And Roisin actually graduated at Goldsmiths in 2009. Her work is about the stealing of other people's works, and she's interested in how she, you know, what this means in terms of ideas. Who owns ideas is her question. So the piece she's got up here is it's a neon light, which isn't switched on, which is a direct replica of Ryan Gander's piece, which he now has disowned because of what she's done. So what happened is, the story is, she went to a neon sign specialist and said, I would like to make a sign which isn't going to be switched on. And the guy said, oh, that's really weird. You're the second artist this week who's come in and done that. And she went, okay, why? Who was the other one? She goes, oh, there's this Turner Prize nominee. I think his name's Ryan Gander. Yeah, that's his piece over there. And she went, can you make me an exact replica of that one, please? And for all sorts of dodgy reasons, the guy did. She exhibited it in her solo show, which caused Ryan no end of grief. And his gallery got in touch with her gallery, and eventually the show got shut down. And he has since disowned the piece, so he no longer owns it. He doesn't want anything to do with it. And I guess the point that becomes interesting to me here is I guess what Roisin is talking about. Who owns ideas? I mean, what's at stake here? What's of value? And I think what's at value here is of freedom, a freedom to learn from others, to express, to continue the discourse. You know, I think copyright and copyleft are very interesting topics, which as artists, I think we'll, you know, for us, well, how can we play with them? I guess that's my question.
Fantastic. I mean, okay, I'm going to come to this. I'll take lots of notes, and it's fascinating. I think the sort of, I mean, the thing I wanted to kind of throw out to begin with was this idea that I mean, it's something that you touched on, Kay, which was the fact that if you go historically, if you go deep into the history of art, you see that plagiarism, however you define it, copying, appropriation, allusion, sampling, is in a sense not only a part of the history of Western art, it is the history of Western art in a sense. Like, so in a way, that's it's kind of its lifeblood, right, in a sense. But also, it's somehow interesting to compare it with other fields of creative endeavor, where copyright is somehow much more of an issue. And what I was writing down, or what I was thinking about when you were talking, was the recent copyright or breach of copyright allegations against musicians, where there's been the appalling singer Robin Thicke was sued by the family of Marvin Gaye for appropriating, not sampling, actually not appropriating, copying in a sense, the sound of one of Marvin Gaye's songs. And I thought, when considering that, I thought it would be impossible to imagine that happening within the art world. But I wondered why you think, I mean, and that's one example of many, right? Because that happens all the time in music, people stealing melodies, etc. It becomes a legal situation, or it becomes just a kind of meme of people discussing this as an idea. Why is it, do you think, that this issue, we can even be sitting here and discussing whether or not it's appropriate or okay to even do this, where we never would within the film, within the realm of music, or within the realm of cinema or other creative fields? Like, why is it that visual art, that fine art, is somehow a field in which this is okay? That's a really laborious question. But you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
So anybody want to address that?
Well, I think it's, I wouldn't say it's okay, but I would say it's, everything has to be done with a conscious thought that you're aware of what you're doing.
Yeah.
You know, there's lots of, if you're doing it as Roisin does, to raise a point, that's interesting.
Right.
If you're doing it in China to sell replicas, that's also interesting, but in a different way. And yeah, I think it's how you we extend our conversation. It's how we continue, as you call it, a lifeblood, because we learn from each other. It's, you know, no artist has emerged from isolation. Every yeah. artist has emerged in response to, or as a reaction to another artist, or another moment, or another movement. Mm-hmm. So we kind of need friction. We kind of need that discomfort, that point at which we can learn or have something to fight against. Artists love nothing better than to have something to fight against.
Sure.
At the moment, you know, it could be, maybe in the near future, it will be the lawyers that we fight against. Or maybe the lawyers will be, or maybe it will be politicians. Maybe right now it's the Conservatives. I don't know, but. Artists do like having something to rally against. They do like being the underdog.
Yeah, sure. But and actually, to follow on from that, to reference something that Laura said earlier on, to go back to Richard Prince, I wrote it down, but I wrote it too quickly to write it articulately. But you were talking about Richard Prince. I mean, after Richard Prince displayed those Instagram photographs at Gagosian, there were defences of Richard Prince, which were historical defences, that said, well, he's Pictures Generation, Sherry Levine, etc., Sturtevant, fine. But there's also the point that you made, and I'm going to misquote you a little bit, but you were talking about Richard Prince's, the criticism that was directed at Richard Prince by artists as well, young artists for the most part, was that it was reflective of his cultural entitlement as an artist who's shown Gagosian. So we're sort of complicating the waters a little bit here, but in an interesting way, I think, because, you know, this idea about who gets to appropriate. Because we're talking, you know, we're talking about different kinds of fields of art, aren't we? So could you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, and who also gets to benefit financially from the appropriation as well.
Right.
So he's in a position where he's visible as an artist within the art world, and he's also showing at places like Gagosian, he's showing at Frieze. So it's that power dynamic, which I think is what I have a problem with in terms of appropriation. Like what you were talking about in terms of using the ways in which artists use appropriation to generate new cultural ideas, I think that's important. But the way that he's doing it, he's taking ownership of things to just generate money and to sort of generate a sort of mystique around him, I kind of find quite uncomfortable.
But true, but isn't that what all artists do to some extent?
I mean, it is,
generating mystique,
yeah.
You know, perhaps making money from it.
Yeah,
although I know that's different to what you were saying earlier, okay, but.
I think that's maybe my own sort of personal politics and preference, which would come into that.
Yeah.
But I think there is an issue where maybe some, because he appropriated artists on Instagram who have large Instagram followings but won't necessarily have the ability to show it Frieze or the networks, sorry, not the ability, the networks to show it Frieze.
Sure.
So that's kind of an issue that I take, so he's kind of undercutting people within the art sphere who don't have the kind of networks and access that he does, the kind of privilege that he has.
Yeah, okay, that's interesting. It's interesting that you bring up the word privilege because it is important here, I think, with relation to this, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, within the market. I mean, if I can bring you in, Masha.
Yeah.
I mean, is it just to think about this notion of who has the status or the privilege of having the ownership of the appropriated image?
Yeah, like those debates were since like 7th century,
right?
6th
yes, true.
Century,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, you're right?
And this like debate who like between, because from one side we have artists who want to monetize and,
yeah.
And there is copyright that exists for that purpose, for making sure that artists can monetize from their creation. On the other side, we also want to share it with the world as much as possible. So where to find that balance? And in a sense that when copyright was like the copyleft, the kind of the definition of copyleft, it's still based on the principles of copyright and its licenses that where you are giving others to appropriate your image. There are like three or four definitions, I don't remember right now, but different licenses, sorry. But when you kind of give the copyleft, it's still a type of license where you're giving permission for others to appropriate your work, but they have to leave it to the others to reappropriate. So it goes kind of, if I share my work with the world, you should you appropriate it, but then you share it again. So it's not for like commercial use, right?
Sure, which actually is very different to this traditional appropriation thing,
yeah.
Which actually is does privilege the appropriator, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah. So in a sense, like, and this dates, like, yeah, in 6th century, thousands of people fought for that, and now thousands of people are fighting for that. So it's something that, for 1500 years been a big debate. But I do feel that there is a type of solution, and the solution is the technology, and to give this kind of power to the creators and not corporations with who have a lot of lawyers or who can afford lawyers, and in a sense people between themselves they can resolve conflicts, right? And sometimes like you talk to people, like you said, a person who got upset, you talk to her, things got resolved, right? So on a human level we can always come to some kind of agreement, right? And till now it was more in the hands of the lawyers to battle against things, right? So I think if we give it somehow to people to resolve it between themselves, maybe that's the better solution.
Yeah, I wonder how a little artist on Instagram talks to Richard Prince though.
Yeah, I think he was quite, I don't know how that played out, he was quite dismissive, I think, wasn't he? There was somebody who really, do you...
There was one of the people who he printed the image out of and started selling her own copies of the image at a cheaper price, and he thought that was fantastic.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, he thought it was fantastic?
Yeah.
But I mean, it doesn't affect him, right? It's kind of
exactly,
whatever,
yeah.
You know, do what you like.
Yeah, in a way he's generated the interest in her.
Sure.
Yeah, but...
But again, she's not selling them for Richard Prince prices.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah.
Does that matter?
Probably not really, but I mean, it doesn't make any difference to him either way, does it?
No,
yeah.
Because I think value is measured in so many different ways.
Sure.
Yeah.
There's the monetary value that you mentioned, which is the freeze art market value.
Yeah.
And there's the cultural value, and also there's the social value. I mean, as an artist, your social networks, you get a bit of recognition or whatever. I don't know how I'd feel if Richard Prince did it to me, but I'd be kind of thinking, yeah, whatever, cool.
Yeah.
Because actually, what? How does that, the values that I'm interested in now, okay, how can I get more sight on my project? How can my own work be seen? Those are the things I care about.
Yeah.
So actually, he's doing me a favor. But he didn't, unfortunately.
Not yet.
Okay, next time.
Yeah.
But I think also in terms of Richard Prince, it comes into this discussion about the art market, right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
it goes beyond the copyright and copyleft.
But yeah. Isn't that part of what we're talking about here to some extent? How artists can monetize their work or no? I mean, isn't that somewhat implied in the discussion about...
Yeah, but then if you go, like how artists monetize, right?
Yeah.
But like then, but after that, like why Richard Prince is represented by Gagosian,
right.
Why you're not, right? Like it's a different right? Yeah, so it's a different, completely different, it's a very different discussion, I think, like in the art market. Who considers that this is high art?
Yeah.
Right? Like, it's a who decides, right?
Sure.
Yeah, that's a different discussion. Yeah.
But it's interesting to see artists that are, whose work is built upon digital appropriation becoming more and more kind of absorbed within that. Right? I mean, I'm just thinking about the fact that John Raffman, you know, who's perhaps maybe his best known, well, I don't know, maybe his best known work, I would think, is his appropriations of Google Street View, you know, which he's sort of re-photographed a la Richard Prince, and then they're displayed as kind of found photography, let's say. And he's now someone who's found a way to make his work into a kind of tangible, physical, buyable object, and now he's had this huge show at the Savilian Exhibition in London. So, is it possible to say that that kind of work is starting to become absorbed by this very market that we're trying to avoid?
I think possibly as well taking images from something like Google, which is Google Street View,
yeah.
is probably seen as being part of the cultural commons now.
Sure.
So in a way, if he's framing things in that way, I think it's different from just from taking something perhaps from another producer and then reproducing it.
Sure.
I think that's where there's issues for people who are making things.
Yeah.
But I think also, like, historically, artists, they work within their society, right? So they work with what society provides them, like,
yeah.
content that society provides them. So during the Renaissance, like, you had all those discoveries, and a lot of artists, like, we see it through the artwork, right?
Sure.
So today, the internet, this is our society, that's where we live, like, I know that nobody, like, I don't know anyone anymore who doesn't have a smartphone,
mm-hmm.
right? So, like, we're so integrated into that, and this is where the artists take their inspiration to their critical thinking, critical, statements, right? So the problem is maybe within the internet itself. Right? Because, like, historically, it started in the 90s, and, like, you have only those one-directional links. Everything you put on the internet, it only goes one direction to forward, right? It never comes back to the original creator. But this idea where you have those double links towards the creator was actually in the history of internet from the 60s.
Right?
Like, you have to, like, this Xanadu project, and Ted Nelson, who was trying to actually bake in copyright and different usage rights into the internet, but somehow it escaped because it just came out in the 90s and World Wide Web came out and it started. So maybe there is the trouble right now that we're talking about is actually inside the internet itself.
Well, actually, I think the point you bring up a great point, actually, Masha, because we weren't expecting the internet.
Exactly.
We didn't know what was coming. We didn't know how to prepare for it. And actually, when you think about what's happening in the other spheres, like film and music, they don't own. You know, they don't sell us DVDs anymore. They don't sell your ownable copy. They sell us the privilege to watch something. So I use Spotify and Netflix, and I don't buy DVDs, I don't buy CDs. Actually, I'm trying to get rid of all these things. And maybe the new internet model is one of less ownership. Maybe we're finally getting to the point where we've always what artists have always wanted to be, where actually we can all, it's a playground, we can, you know, who cares who owns what, let me borrow it for a second, can I play with it and I'll give it back to you. I don't know, maybe that's the utopia we've all been dreaming about.
Yeah.
It is utopian, totally, yeah, absolutely, but there's still, sorry to keep going back to this, there's still this problem of like, how does it then enter into the discourse of contemporary art? I mean, you know, if we're talking about artists who define themselves as artists, but there's a lot of work on the internet which isn't made by artists, but it's still very much appropriation. I think about like a supercut, for example, you know, like a YouTube video which is a compilation of all the times that Nicolas Cage shouts and screams, which is great, by the way. You have to see that. So I mean, that to me is, you know, it's like a Christian Mark Clay or something. Like, it's a really, the person doing it would sneer, I imagine, would sneer at the idea of being called an artist because it's, you know, because it isn't, it's a laugh, right? But it is also very carefully made. It's taken a long time. It's very well crafted. It's very, you know, in its own way, like very thoughtful. But don't we enter this, to be a devil's advocate for a second, don't we enter this realm whereby, you know, the art world, you know, within which artists are trained and, you know, within which artists show their work and are misunderstood, has this problem of how does it deal with that kind of production?
Well, it's the same as it's always been. I mean, we've always had painters who aren't artists. We've always had people who draw who aren't artists. It's.
But what does it mean for artists who are working?
The same as it's always meant for artists who are painters, and they've got weekend painters who surround them. It's fine. It's an understanding that there is a difference, and the art world can see the difference. The general public may not, but that's okay. It's for them to find and discover at a different point. I don't think it's changed, really.
Mm. I was going to say, Morgan Quaintance curated a show at Cell Projects last year, which included a video of sort of like cuts of Kilroy silk saying lots of really ridiculous things, which was made by a YouTube user who you don't know who it is, but it was put in a show with other artists who've got recognisable names, so he'd kind of elevated that kind of cultural production to being as interesting as what the contemporary art scene is creating as well. So I think there is space for that, especially within perhaps a more curatorial practice, if you've got that kind of eye and interest to bring that in within a context where other contemporary art is showing. I don't think it's not that unusual.
It's probably time to ask if anybody's got any questions, because I know that we have artists in the audience, but I don't know who everyone is, but does anyone have any thoughts, questions, comments, ideas that have been raised so far? Yeah.
I'd like to ask about the difference between using an image and stealing the image somehow, because that's what if you talk to an open source activist, for example, they would not call it stealing, they'd say it's accessible, it's a use, it's, you know, information that should fly free. So, how do you determine what's using, what's stealing?
Yeah, okay. I guess stealing, if we bring it back to real world, is when somebody says, you can't have it, it's mine, and you go and take it.
Yeah,
that's stealing.
Yeah.
You put something out there, and somebody appropriates it. That's a gray area, but it's not, that would be it for me. What do you guys think?
I don't know, I think it's defined in terms of the sort of how the person who made it, I think it's all, could be a personal preference as to how they want their work to be distributed. I think stealing is a difficult word, I think, in this context, because not everyone will see reappropriation as being theft. I think that depends on your politics, I think.
Actually, you bring up you just reminded me of something yesterday. I was invigilating upstairs, and one of the artists, Rob Cross, has got this beautiful video piece. And I realised that there's a girl sitting there, she must have been about 15, with her iPhone, recording the whole thing. And I was like, what do I do?
Yeah.
What do I do? Nothing.
Yeah.
By the time I figured out that I should probably ask her not to do it, she'd finished and left.
Which is a problem. Yeah, problem.
I have a related question, which is your distinction between Google Maps and Google Earth being the cultural commons and Instagram somehow not being, which is, comes through your distaste with rich prints. And I thought what you were saying about the cultural commons essentially is what we say it is, right? And so if our internet society says Instagram is the cultural commons, which I think it sort of does, I don't know, why do you draw that distinction?
I think it's because he purposefully took images from users who are other cultural producers, but less well known.
Google is a cultural producer.
Yeah, that's true, but they also, they can make a living.
Why is that important? Like, Keh's point, why is it matter? So why are you interested in your interest in printers? So what? Like, what would you have happen to rich prints in an ideal world?
I don't know.
but that's a very important point.
I think it's more to do with the what we were talking before about privilege. And also what I was talking about before in relationship to there being, to the cultural markets being a labour market, where there's a percentage who get money from sort of like, they take, what was it, what was it?
You said top 10%.
Yeah, take 45% of the earnings. And I was talking about how within the Western economies particularly, the sort of middle income earners are vanishing.
Yeah.
And that's a cultural problem for everybody.
Yeah.
And so that's why I have a particular issue with what Richard Print, the action that he took on Instagram was because he took images from people who are probably within that cultural middle who are unable to make an income from their practice.
But he wasn't encroaching on a marketplace they were even trying to participate in. Like, what I thought was incredibly interesting by then selling those canvases at $90, there could not have been a more emphatic illustration of the fact that they were not taking place in that market. You know.
Or they had access to that market, so he has privilege of the access to that market, whereas those people don't necessarily. I'm talking about his privilege of access to the networks where he can sell money for that amount of, can sell work for that amount of money. I think it's
yeah. Yeah, no. I mean, would it make you happier if Richard Prince decided to pay those artists?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
But that would be random largesse rather than like the labour market working properly.
Well, yeah.
I mean, just random.
But the labour market is a problem in itself, like in general.
So I'm interested in how people do a lot of stuff that isn't saleable, but is about building a reputation, and then profit at the end from the reputation.
Yeah.
Now, I think actually Instagram is a lot better anyway. So those people are suicide girls. So why are they doing that? Why are they putting all this stuff out in the world for free? Partly because they want to generate a reputation that you can then trade off in some way.
Yeah.
Which Prince is saying, isn't that interesting? Now, I find his participation in that absolutely valuable and interesting.
Yeah.
And I take Keh's view, which is, so what about money? Like, the fact that he's looking at that and saying that, you know, you're doing this thing about fluffing up your reputation and I can just travel over it. To me, that's a fascinating thing to say.
Okay.
He's not always, like, uncomfortable and, you know,
I'm uncomfortable with the power dynamic, which I've already explained, but that's what I have an issue with. The power dynamic, where he has the privilege to do that, whereas the people, perhaps, within the network of Instagram don't. That's it.
It feels a bit like exploitation, maybe.
Yeah.
But can exploitation sometimes just be interesting? Like, my question is, should you stop from doing it?
Well, you can't stop if it's digital.
If you have very robust legal systems that said that is not on, you could stop it. And the question is, should we have that legal structure that stops it?
Occasionally people try to.
Yeah.
It's in there's a case last year where Luke Toynbee repainted an image of a Belgian politician was taken by a photojournalist, and he was, I mean, he had to pay something like 3,000 euros to drop that. And so, considering that's not just taking the image and printing it on canvas again, that's actually moving it into paint, which you would think is more of a authentic, I don't know, less close reappropriation. He got loads of trouble, so.
So my question is that desirable?
No, I don't think it's desirable, but it seems like it's really so loose that you can't predict what's going to happen to you when can we appropriate? Because in some places you're going to.
And that's what Masha's saying about the law being so unpredictable. Because when the law is unpredictable, that works in favor of the powerful. Because when there's an uncertainty, only the ones who can afford to enforce it can then have the law on their side. That's why.
But if, imagine if on the internet you had next to every image there would be like, okay, I don't care about who takes this image, but for those, at least like to give the tool and the choice for the creators to decide for themselves, do you care or don't you care, right? And then when like somebody goes on the internet, they know kind of, because right now when you go to the internet and you, like even when I try to find images for my slides, I have no idea who to contact. I have no idea like where to go, right? So if you actually had that information and attribution, right, very clear, and then the artist would decide for themselves what they want to do with that, right? So I think that's powerful.
Yeah, I think the Richard Prince example is maybe a bit of a red herring, because actually Instagram's terms and conditions basically say you no longer own your image once you put it on there. So actually, you probably have no legal grounds anyway, you've given it up. And in terms of thinking about it, in terms of exploitation, I don't know, I think there's lots of other images on the internet which are more exploitative than that relationship of Richard Prince taking a maker. I like this person, or I want to show this person. He's sort of acting as a curator from Instagram. So, yeah, I think there's probably other examples which might be more problematic. None come to mind, but I think Prince, I actually quite like Richard Prince, so yeah.
But Masha, is this something that you come across professionally? There are presumably artists who come to you and say, "Send to me,"
We have artists who come from both, right? Like we have artists who say, "We don't care, like we want to share as much as possible, but we do care about attribution." Right, and this is what a scribe also helps with, right? So your work is always attributed to you, so it's not getting lost in this big black hole. But then will come artists who say, like, I never put anything on the internet, even on my website for my video, I only put like 5 stills, right?
Yeah.
And we want to make sure that I have 5 editions all registered on blockchain through a scribe, and I transfer the ownership of each edition to the new owner, to the collector, and this is like the scarcity, the digital scarcity.
Yeah.
So we have both, right? Like you have different artists, and that's the beauty of the art world. You have so many artists, and in the art world, you build on like ideas on top of ideas. In the tech, you build tech on top of tech, right? But this is what the beauty is, that like, and the whole idea of a scribe was to make sure people have the tool to do whatever they want to do. And it's up to them to decide what they want to do, right? And that's it. So if you don't care, you just put it on the internet. If you do care about attribution, you still have that. Or if you're like artist who sells editions, you have the ability to create this unique digital editions.
When you were talking about Richard Prince earlier, the phrase that came up, that ownership, breaking the ownership, is something that you did not create in selling it. But I think that the conflict goes much, much further into digital spaces and any physical spaces. Because I'm thinking about more like spatial as well. Because, okay, for instance, Cezanne is a landscape, and there is a house in this landscape. The house was built by someone, and he's putting it in his picture. Basically, kind of breaking the ownership of this landscape, because he didn't create the landscape, but he's still like reproducing it. And then performance as well, like on Freeze, there's this performance about hair Siamese twins. And it's being sold, like it's a recreation of this famous 60s photograph, and it's being sold for 20,000 quid. And and but with one condition, that the twins have to be your own children. And so basically, if I find some random twins who are 12 years old and I kind of intertwine their hair and I ask them to go around the art exhibition, look at the art objects, whisper like secrets to each other what these like twins, these twins are doing. I can do it. I can do it in my house, I can do it in any gallery, no one will necessarily see it. But am I still breaking the law if nobody sees it?
Hey, it's a great question. I mean, I don't know. I mean, what do you think? It's a re-performed performance piece. I mean, we were talking earlier on about Tino Segal.
Yeah.
You know, it's a good example of somebody who sells work to museums. There's no paper trail, as it were. There's no documentation of it. There's no contract.
Marina
Abramovich, exactly. But where do we go from that? I mean, because... Go on. You're ready to jump in.
I think, especially now in this world where copies are so easy to make and ideas, like someone once said, ideas are cheap, right? It's all about execution. I think it's not about the copy anymore. Like, copies should be like accessible to everyone. It's all about the title, right? Like, it's all about, yeah, the title. So there can be like thousands of copies. But you have, like, even with Rafael Rosendahl, right?
Yeah.
His website is sold to the collector. And it's a title that is sold to the collector. The website is accessible to absolutely everyone.
Right.
Right? Like, you can put it in your home on the screen. Do you own it? You have access to it.
Right.
But the owner is actually the owner of the title. Right? So... Why not to make it accessible? But then at the same time, we do need also to think about that artists in 21st century should be able to monetize from their work too.
Sure.
And this is where the title comes into, right? So, yeah, I think copies are, it's going to happen, like it's digital, it's spreadable, it's just flying everywhere. So, like, and restricting it, it's not the solution.
Yeah.
But I understand what you're saying, but I have to disagree because if we're thinking, for instance, about Marina Abramovich, work that she does, long duration work, it's actually so difficult. And, like, I've done both of her performances that participated, and I know how difficult it is. Like, she has this performance about Francine Rice, where you have to, it's like kind of this little mountain of rice and lentils, and you have to separate them from each other, and then you have to count how many lentils and rice are in each, like, little mountain again. And it goes up to, like, 12,000, and you just do it, and you sit and you do it. And I think that it's okay to reproduce the performance under artists' surveillance, and, you know, in a space where she agrees that you can do it, but to do it outside, I think it's on a different level because it's more like immoral, slightly immoral, because you're saying that, yeah, right, she can do it, I can do it too in my kitchen.
But it's immoral to separate
yeah.
rice and lentils.
No, yes, but I think it is.
I mean, it's only important because, I mean, who cares?
Well, the work only happens within a particular circumscribed space anyway, right? I mean, if you do it in your kitchen, it isn't the work.
Exactly. And you know that Marina Abramovich, that's the original,
yes.
right? So if you do it at home, like, who cares?
But I think it's more about the intention. What's your intention when you're doing it at home in the kitchen?
Exactly.
If your intention is, I'm doing this to rip Marina Abramovich off, or I'm just cooking.
Even that's a bit afraid to rip her off. I mean,
Even then, yeah.
But doesn't it go back to what we were talking about earlier on? I mean, with the Ryan Gander, still up there with the Ryan Gander piece. I mean,
yeah.
Do we use rip off for that?
She calls herself an art thief. So yeah, she
calls herself an art thief.
Yeah, yeah.
But she's talking about that within a history of art thievery, isn't she?
Yeah, and that's her practice.
Right.
And she's very aware of what she's doing.
Yeah.
But I think if you're a punter, you've gone and seen a Marina Abramovic performance, and you go, oh, that's really interesting, I want to go home and try for myself. That's, I consider that learning, or trying on somebody else's shoes, you know, it's kind of that. If you're doing that, you're going to go and call it your own artwork and not reference the other artists in what you're saying, the idea of the titling, then that's also interesting but problematic, I guess.
What the work is about or not, doesn't it come down to that? I mean, if you're making work that is about virality or whatever it might be, I mean, there is a John Raffman piece, which is a Mariah Carey music video, I think that's John Raffman, which is kind of, he takes out all of the video except for the singer, and then he kind of released it, as it were, onto YouTube, and it became something that was then transformed by this enormous number of people, not all of whom would consider themselves to be artists. So the subject of that work, in order to be successful, it has to be entered into the system you describe. But there are certainly artists whose, which is why a scribe exists to some extent, right? There are artists whose work is not about that kind of, you know, it is perhaps appropriated or whatever it might be, but it doesn't exist within a culture of appropriation in the way that one does.
But then they wouldn't share it.
Then they wouldn't, well.
It would just kind of give it to whoever is meant to see it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. Okay, well, thank you so much to Masha, to Kay, to Laura for coming along. I thought it was a fantastic discussion. Remember, it's been filmed, it's going to be on the website so you can watch it again. And thank you all very much for coming along. Thanks. Enjoy the rest of Sluice.